This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Hey, good to be with you this morning. One day stand. And flowers, beautiful flowers, are given in the loving memory of Bobby Baird, Isaac Baird, and Albertson families. This is, if you came in through the chapel lobby, this is our month to support the food pantry. I was with the major just a couple of days ago, and the shelves are somewhat bare, so we would appreciate it. We have the whole month, so I'm hopeful that there are baskets at different locations. So we just ask you to be very generous with your giving. Are there any other announcements that I have missed? No.
Worship with these words from Natalie Sleeves, hymn of promise. In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree.
In the cocoons and in the promise, butterflies will soon be free.
In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that waits to be.
Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody.
There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me.
From the past will come the future, what it holds, a mystery.
Unrevealed until its seasons, something God alone can see. Our doubt there is believing, and our life eternity.
In our resurrection at last, a victory.
Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Thanks be to God for forgiving you and me. Please rise. Passing the peace that comes from sinners shows Christ willing to forgive us and others and to be forgiven. Peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Come forward.
joy, live according to it, and grow in faith and hope and love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from Psalm 95, verses 1 through 7. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and the dry land which his hands have formed. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would listen to his voice, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel lesson this morning comes from Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. Listen to this very familiar parable. When he entered Jericho and was passing through it, the man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowds he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. And so he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, he is going to be the guest of one of those who is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek out and to save the lost. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Thank you.
New Testament reading is taken from Paul's letter to the Ephesians in chapter 4. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up to love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. And now, O God, tell us what we need to hear. Show us what we need to do in order to be faithful and obedient to your Lord, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. Last Sunday was Reformation Sunday, and the mood of that service was very upbeat, a day when we were celebrating the beginning of Protestantism. Now today we've come to another section where we say that we believe in the Holy Catholic Church, that we believe in the communion of saints. And the next Sunday, kind of the mood of today will be continued, and then in addition, Reverend Carl Heilbach, we shall be having the sacrament of the Lord's Supper as part of our worship. So, the Protestant Reformation, the creed, and then from there we move on. Now, I am aware about this article of the creed, that there is a great deal of misunderstanding and hesitation. Some Protestants repeat this part of the creed with tongue in cheek, for they have allowed the word Catholic to become a designation of that branch of Christendom which looks to the Pope in Vatican City for its leadership and authority. But the question which faces us then is this: are we being asked to affirm something that we as Protestant Christians do not believe? Or have we allowed certain great and meaningful words to slip out of our vocabulary? What do we really say when we repeat these words, "I believe in the Holy Catholic Church"? I believe in the communion of saints. The communion of saints. Now, first thing to note is that we believe in the Church of Jesus Christ. We believe in the Church of Jesus Christ. this affirmation might be taken for granted, except for the fact that there are those who call themselves Christians, who by their disinterest indicate that the church is not necessary for Christian faith and life. Such persons are quick to point out the faults and weaknesses of the church, and because it's not perfect, they accept themselves wrong. You know, it's been said, and rightly so, that if the church were not perfect, all it would take to make it different would be the attendance of some of its critics. But these reasons why people absent themselves from the church are but excuses, and poor excuses at that. The real reason is this: such persons do not want to assume responsibilities which their affiliation with the Church of Jesus Christ would impose upon them. In effect, such people want to be spiritually irresponsible. Now, perfectly clear that a person can worship God anywhere, in spirit and in truth. But the question is, how many people do worship God outside of the church or without the inspiration and support of the church? Now, it's true that the church is shot through with faults and is handicapped by its weaknesses. After all, the church is made up of people like you and me. It's not for people who are perfect. It's for those who know they are not as good as they ought to be, and who come to God's house to that they tell that they may be better. I like what a fellow Presbyterian pastor has written. The church is the only society in the world in which membership is based upon a single qualification: if the candidate shall be deemed unworthy of membership. Now, as indicated in your bulletin this morning, the word saint in the New Testament is applied to every Christian. And Paul's letter to the Ephesians, for example, is addressed to the saints which are at Ephesus. In other words, to Ephesian Christians. Then, the second thing to note about this article of the Creed is that we believe that the church is holy. The church is holy. Now, do not mean perfect. The church is perfect. Anyone who has had any part about the church in general, or let's be specific, let's be specific about this church. It's not where we are now, but rather in what direction we are moving. We believe that the church is holy in that it is the one fellowship and institution in human society which is set aside entirely for the service and glory of God. It is proclamation of this church to minister to the needy souls of God's people. My friends, don't forget it. This church is not just another fraternal society. It's not just a service club. It's not just a community organization. This church, like other churches, this church is the body of Jesus Christ. It is the hands through which Christ works. It is the feet through which Christ carries the word of reconciliation and peace. It's the mouth through which Christ preaches the gospel. So my friends, the worthwhileness of everything which the church does needs to be measured by this fact. Well, this then is what hopefully you feel like I, that we believe in the church. But I have a real concern. It's not what we believe about the church. It's what we believe in the church. So I challenge you. Do you believe in the church enough to pray for her? To support her with your time, your talent, your treasure, and to give her the very best that we have. And so, can you say with conviction, I believe in the Holy Catholic Church?
Born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
God. And God will draw near to you. Let us pray. In the silence of this room, which we call a sanctuary, we turn our hearts and minds to you, O God, knowing that all good things come from you. We consider this a privilege to engage in public worship, to share our cares, our burdens with one another, as we face the opportunities of another day. There are so many cares and concerns which we carry upon our hearts and minds. We would pray, O God, that you would be to each person gathered here this day, be a source of strength and support. We're grateful, O God, that we have this opportunity for public worship. We pray that we would keep in mind why we say that we believe in the communion of saints. Now, O God, as we lift our hearts and minds to you in prayer, we would offer that prayer which Christ told his disciples, a prayer which includes these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Where do you spend your time? If your checking account was your time account, where are you spending your time? If the average American spends an hour a day on the internet, how many hours does the average Christian spend reading the Bible? Our call today is for good stewardship or time spent with God. Where will you spend your time? Yes.
Thank you.
Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
God to take you home, and let's say together, Amen. Amen.